I'm just going to take a few minutes and talk through it. And then, beginning in Romans 3:10, we're just going to read. And then beginning in Romans 3:19, we're going to read. And all I'm going to do as I read along is add in the commentary that we brought to those verses the 2 weeks that we spent in that, so that we have that gospel message refreshed in our memory. Then what I'm desirous to do is, if that is the core of the gospel there in Romans 3:19 and following, can we see that in the book of Acts? And I believe that we can see those truths brought out in the book of Acts. And so in Acts, we're just going to go and we're going to kind of read through a couple areas of scripture rather quickly, slowing down where the gospel is given so that we can see that. Because really, I have two desires for this morning. One, that if there is someone who has not received the good news of the gospel yet, that today would be the day that they would get saved. Today would be the day that they would receive that gospel message. But my desire is for those of us that know the Lord and love Him and have received the gospel message, that that message would be refreshed in our mind and our heart as we've looked at it in detail in the past. Don't want to do that again here in Romans. But we'd be refreshed in the big picture message of the gospel, not only so that we can celebrate what is ours through the sacrifice, death, burial, and resurrection and ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, but also that we can then be refreshed in our method and our mode and our desire for evangelism. One of the things of having been gone for the last couple of weeks and just mixing in with people that I wouldn't normally get to see, you know, you're on vacation, so you're going places and you're doing things, and just struck by how much the world needs Jesus. And some people open to receiving that gospel message and had that opportunity, but some people who just hardened-hearted, don't want to hear. And so those are the things that are reverberating in my heart and resonating with me for the morning. And then we'll wrap up the morning by celebrating communion as we have been looking at the gospel message and rejoicing in that truth, to be able to take the bread, to be able to take the cup, and to be able to hold those elements and remember what the Lord Jesus did for us. Then, should the Lord tarry and we're back next Sunday, we will pick up our Bible study in Romans, looking at justification and righteousness in chapter 4 there. So that's kind of the outline of where we're going. Some people, I know you like when I give you an outline where we're going. Some people hate it. They prefer to be surprised. So, but anyway, that's the plan for where we're at today. So to this point in the book of Romans, Paul, writing this letter to Christian believers, both those who have come out of Judaism and those who are Gentiles, but now are lovers of Christ living in the city of Rome, Paul opens his letter with an introduction, and his letter is going to deal with the gospel message. And certainly in the first 8 chapters, we deal with the themes of condemnation for sin, justification in the Lord Jesus Christ, coming to that place of being justified, just as if I've never sinned, the righteousness of Christ given to us that we can have right standing with God, sanctification, being set apart unto the Lord. We're no longer a part of the world. We now belong to the Lord. And then glorification, that time that we look forward to in the future, where we will be with the Lord in the heavenlies forever and for always. And just recapping quickly, because we want to be reminded of this, that condemnation that we talked about, and Paul details for us in chapters 1, verses 18 through chapter 3, verses 20, he talked about, we came up with an outline speaking about impurities. He talked about heterosexual impurity, homosexual impurity, habitual impurity, self-righteous impurity, religious impurity, and then absolute, what we call absolute impurity. That is, everybody is condemned in their sin. So what becomes beautiful is that making our way as we did, man, that tough slide through those three chapters of just week after week after week after week of talking about that sin, we rejoice then to talk about the righteousness given to us in Christ. We rejoiced in being talking about being justified, made just as if we'd never sinned. And we'll continue to enjoy talking about sanctification and looking forward to the glorification that the Lord has for us in the future. So what I want to do is I want to kind of summarize that condemnation. If you look with me, Romans chapter 3, verse 10. Romans 3:10, as Paul summarizes here, we will do the same. He says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. No, none. There's none righteous apart from the Lord Jesus. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable. There is none who does good. No, not one. Just stopping and commenting for a moment, I like to be reminded of that because sometimes I'm faced with people that I look on at their life, they're not saved, and I think, you know, I look at their life and everything looks so good. They look so good. Why would they possibly need to hear the gospel from me? There's none righteous. No, not one. And it's a very sweet thing because then when we're faced with the opportunity for evangelism, we don't have to ask the Lord, Lord, does this person need to hear the gospel? We don't have to ask that question. Anybody who's not saved needs to hear the gospel. There's none righteous, no, not one. The only question that we have to ask is, Lord, would you have me to now, at this moment, share you, Lord Jesus? There's none who does good. In fact, verse 13, their throat is an open tomb. We talked about that, everything that comes out, the stench and the stink of sin. With their tongues, they've practiced deceit. When they speak, it's deceitful. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. The foulness that comes out of people's mouth. Man, what an indicator of the sin that is in their heart. Interesting, during Victorian times and following, you could be cited legally for using bad language in front of a lady or in polite company. Those days are gone. You're out there and about, and cursing and bitterness, they're all around you. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. So sad, so lost. You know, it's interesting, too, that for the sinner, the one living in rebellion to God, not only is there destruction coming into their life from the outside, no matter how good they look, but there's destruction that wells up from within them. They destroy themselves through their own decisions and the directions that they take. In verse 17 of Romans 3, and the way of peace they have not known. They're looking for peace. Maybe this relationship will bring peace. Maybe this new career will bring peace. Maybe it'll be this house and this location that will bring peace. Maybe it'll be this influx of cash that'll bring peace. Maybe it'll be this new exercise regimen or this new diet. Maybe it'll be this new drug. Maybe it'll be this new fetish that the world foists upon them. Looking for peace. They have not known it. They will not know it apart from Jesus. And there is no fear of God before their eyes. They use his name as an exclamation. They use his name as a curse word. There's no respect. Many, many years ago, when the internet was being birthed, I was speaking with somebody who's kind of in the tech world, and they said to me, speaking about just reading different articles and different blog posts and this sort of thing. They said to me, don't ever read the comments. Just don't ever read the comments. And I remember after they said that to me thinking, well, you know, that's kind of unusual. And so, of course, you know, I'm like maybe anybody else. I went and read the comments. And all the filth. So I was recently, a link was sent to me of somebody who loves the Lord and had written a blog posting that was very encouraging, I guess, you know, if you're into that sort of thing, of what they were speaking about and just, you know, checking it out. And I thought, you know, I wonder how people are reacting to this. And so I violated that rule again that I went and I read the comments. And what I was thinking, because of the website that the blog was associated with, I was thinking that the comments would, you know, be Christians, you know, expressing an opinion or something like this. And overwhelmingly, the comments were non-believers. And the things that they had to say about my Jesus, and the things that they had to say about the Bible, and the things that they had to say about the kingdom of God, there was no fear, there is no fear of God before their eyes. Again, I'll only read you a snippet of it. William MacDonald says, this then, this section that we've just read, it's God's x-ray of the human race. It reveals universal unrighteousness, ignorance, and independence toward God, waywardness, unprofitableness, and lack of any goodness. Man's throat is full of rottenness, his tongue is deceitful, his lips are venomous. Did anyone look at any pictures? Have you seen any media coverage of the, what will we call them, the demonstrations or the riots down in Charlottesville yesterday? To see the hate, to see, to look on and to look at people's faces, to look at their postures. Man's throat is full of rottenness, his tongue is deceitful, his lips are venomous, his mouth is full of swearing, his feet are bent on murder. That's how you can plow a car into a whole group of people. He leaves behind trouble and destruction. He doesn't know how to make peace. And he has no regard for God. MacDonald says, here we see the total depravity of man, by which we mean that sin has affected all of mankind and that it has affected every part of his being. Obviously, every man has not committed every one of these sins. But he has a nature. This is apart from Christ. He has a nature which is capable of committing them all. So Paul summates then this section of condemnation that man comes under for his sin in verse 19. If you'd look there with me, Romans 3:19. And again, I will begin to add in the commentary that we developed in our earlier studies through this section is this morning, just teaching topically. Now we know, verse 19 of Romans 3, now we know that whatever the law says, it says to all those who are under the law that every mouth that's opened in self-righteousness, opened in self-justification, every mouth may be stopped and silenced due to the overwhelming evidence against them. It's like the individual that stands before the judge, the prosecutor, and the prosecutor makes his case, and the individual declares before the judge, I'm guilty. You got me. Guilty to the core. Every mouth may be stopped. Look at this. And all the world, whether they're the religious Jew, whether they're a Gentile, whether they're religious or whether they're non-religious, all the world may become guilty, that is, brought under judgment before God. Therefore, verse 20, by the deeds or by obedience to the law, no flesh, no man, no woman will be justified or will be made righteous in God's sight. Nobody can do enough good. Nobody's good deeds can outweigh their bad deeds in such a way that they stand righteous before God, that they stand justified before God. Why is this? For by or through the law is the knowledge of sin. Not the knowledge of salvation, we noted, but the knowledge of sin. The law merely communicates that we need a Savior. So Paul then brings to us, beginning in verse 21 down through verse 26, the gospel message of what it means to be justified before the Lord. And when we entered into this area a few weeks back, I asked you to have this noted in your Bible and maybe even noted in your heart, maybe even memorized. I started a couple weeks ago memorizing scripture. I've told you many times I'm not a memorizer. I want to be. But man, I can't even remember just the daily things of life and living, let alone adding something else in there. But I found an app. I know it's hard to believe. I found an app. And the app, and I'm only sharing this because not because of me, but if you're a person who struggles in this way that I do, maybe, you know, I can turn you on to my app. But this app, you put in the verse. You don't even have to type the verse in, which you probably should have to because it'd help you memorize it. But it'll plug in the verse for you, whatever translation that you want. And then it'll read the verse to you. It will leave the verse, will leave words out, and you have to fill them in. Or it will cloud verse words out, and you have to, you know, keep going through the verse. It uses a multitude of different ways to help you remember the verse. And I've almost got it. In fact, it's three verses that it, 11, 12, four verses that I'm working on memorizing. All this little passage. I've always wanted to hold that area of scripture in my heart. And so maybe you're one who you'd want to plug this one into your app, or plug it into your heart at the least. Romans 3:21. But now, verse 21, after three chapters of condemnation and conviction for sin, but now the righteousness that's given by God, apart from the law or separate from the law, is revealed, is made known, being now witnessed by the law and the prophets. The Old Testament bringing to us an understanding, hey, this is the truth of God's word, the truth of the gospel. Even verse 22, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Through believing in Jesus Christ, through entrusting oneself to Jesus Christ, through reliance upon Jesus Christ. And could I highlight that word for us for a moment as we make our way through this text? That I think that there would be many Christians that you could say, hey, do you have faith in Jesus? They might say yes. Hey, do you believe in Jesus? Oh, I believe. Okay. But I think, does it put a finer point on it when we say, do you entrust yourself to Jesus? Turning it inwards, when I ask myself, do I have reliance upon Jesus? Do I rely upon Him? You know, there's an accusation from the world that says that we as Christians, we use Jesus and Christianity as a crutch. I didn't have an answer for that many years ago, and then I heard Greg Laurie say, oh, my Jesus, Christianity for me is not a crutch. It is a fully operational, fully automatic wheelchair. And I went, yeah, that's reliance. One of the locations we were at saw a beautiful, beautiful little girl. And she's swimming around in the pool, just swimming like a fish, happy, you know, just in there with the other kids. She went to get out of the pool. And for the first time I noticed when she went to get out of the pool, she had pink crutches that came up through her hands and fastened on her biceps. And she used those crutches to walk across the pool deck. She was reliant on those crutches. See, the righteousness of God from the law is revealed through faith or reliance in Jesus Christ. And again, the text tells us it's to all and on all, so it's for everyone. There's nobody that we have to think they're beyond. I referenced already the individual who plowed their car into the demonstrators yesterday in Charlottesville. I think it was either late last night or this morning. I can't remember when I first saw it, but there's a picture of him, and now there's a name. I prayed for his salvation. God desires that he would be born again, that he'd have life everlasting, that he'd be set free. It's the gospel is to all, and it's on all. Notice who believe. You have to believe. You have to entrust. You have to exercise reliance upon the Lord. His death and his suffering, his cleansing, the gospel message, it's sufficient for everyone, we noted, but it's effective for those who believe. It's only effective for those who take it, who receive it, who live in it. Paul goes on to say, he says, there is no difference, that is no difference between Jew or Greek or religious and non-religious. There's no difference between anyone. All have sinned, he says in verse 23. Not only in Adam have all sinned, the human race has been plunged into sin through Adam, but all have sinned individually as well as corporately. All have sinned, we notice the tense was in the past, all have sinned in the past in Adam, and all are falling, we notice the tense. They all are falling short. It's continuous. You're continuously falling short of the glory of God. Again, another way of Paul communicating to us that all men are guilty. All men are guilty. And all men have been given the gift of salvation. Will they receive it or not? All men have given. I like that. I like to think about the fact that all men are guilty. All men have been gifted. The question is, which men will receive the gift? All men won't receive the gift. Some men will leave the gift. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified or declared righteous freely. There's no charge for it. I'm in verse 24. There's no charge for this declaration. It's a free gift by his grace. See, it's freely gifted. It's unearned. It's unmerited through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. Jesus paid the price. To redeem, redemption, Jesus paid the price. You and I, we don't have to pay. There are many religious systems today that do want to pay a price, and the people are held under this cloud of control by those religious systems seeking to get them to pay a price, whether it's monetary or whether it's some sort of action or this sort of thing. But there is no charge. It is all freely gifted of God's grace. It is Christ who paid the price. How did this price that Christ paid, verse 25, well, whom God, it was his plan, he set forth Jesus in a public display. Jesus wasn't crucified in some far off corner somewhere that no one would know about it. No, the crucifixion of a man named Jesus of Nazareth, it's a historical fact. Agreed to by all. They may not all agree that he is the Messiah, but they do all agree that a man named Jesus from Nazareth was crucified there in Jerusalem on a Roman cross. So public display of his son, crucified as a propitiation. We talked about the mercy seat that blood sprinkled on the Ark of the Covenant, that blood that cleanses, that blood that pays the price. By his blood, there's the price, through faith. And we talked about the fact that biblically, where there is sin, there must be sacrifice. Where there's sin, somebody or something must die. Blood must be shed. The only way sin can be dealt with is through shed blood. And the blood can only be shed through death. And so God says, hey, I will send my son, Christ Jesus. I will sacrifice him. He will make propitiation. He, his blood, will pay the price. And it will be effective to you and I. And sometimes I used to think, man, I wish I had been there at the cross. Now I've walked with the Lord a few more years. I'm so glad I wasn't there at the cross. You know, sometimes I used to think that I, you know, might be John peeking over a rock, watching what was going on. And then I knew I wasn't John. And then I thought I might be Peter, you know, and oh gosh, yeah, I'd probably be the one, you know, denying him before, you know, things even went down. And then I've come to realize that the reality is if I was there, I'd probably be Mark running away naked from the Garden of Gethsemane. Anything to get out of there. You know, I don't want to see this. No, the sacrifice is made effective for us, not because we were at the cross, but it's made effective for us, again, through faith, through belief, through entrusting, through reliance, through giving ourselves over. Now, God did this to demonstrate, I'm in the back half of verse 25, to demonstrate his righteousness, to demonstrate God's righteousness, that he is right and he has a right plan. And his plan is the best plan because in his forbearance or because in his patience, God had passed over the sins that were previously committed, sins that were committed before Christ, to demonstrate at this present time his righteousness. And we made note of the fact in the past that at the cross, in the action and activity of the cross, sin was backward cleansed to Adam, and sin was forward cleansed right on up to eternity. This is what that text is telling. This is how we can sit here this morning, and if we're born again believers in Jesus Christ, we can be refreshed in the reminder that our sin is forgiven. All that we've committed in the past, all that we may be committing now, and all that we will commit in the future. Wow. He demonstrates at the present time, verse 26, his righteousness, that he, God, might be just, or he might be righteous, and the justifier, or the one who makes believers righteous, those who have faith, the one who has faith in Jesus. Take note of the word of the one, it's a personal and individual decision. My son's not saved because I'm saved. Your daughter isn't saved because you're saved. It is an individual choice. It is the one who puts their faith in Jesus. Not only can you not have my faith won't work for you. We each have to have our own faith in Jesus, that he is my Savior, that he is my Redeemer, that he paid the price for me, that he, and here's how we sometimes say it, right? He took my So Jesus, he not only cleanses us from sin, that's forgiveness, but he gives to us, he charges to us righteousness. So God looks on at us, God the Father, God the Creator, God the Master of the universe, he looks on us and here's what he sees. He sees us forgiven because of the blood of his Son, and he sees us righteous. Not because of who we are, not because of what we've done, but he looks at us and he sees the righteousness of his Son upon us. And we took that picture of putting on a big, thick bathrobe. Remember that? And we talked about that robe being the picture of righteousness. It's given to us. It's robed upon us. It's not us. We're not made righteous. We are covered in the righteousness. We are imputed with righteousness. Righteousness is charged to our account. We stand in the righteousness of the Lord Jesus. So there's the recap of the gospel. So let's quickly look. I turned and asked you to turn to Acts chapter 2. If you turn there with me now, verse 36. So there's a couple themes that come to us out of the gospel, out of this area of Romans that we looked at, that the righteousness through faith is to everybody, Jew and Gentile, and everybody can access the righteousness of faith that's found in Jesus. We also saw that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All are sinners. All are in need of the righteousness of Christ. We also saw that we're declared righteous with no charge because it's a free gift of salvation. It's a free gift. So that's another theme that we saw there in Romans. And fourthly, we saw that God is the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. That is to say, that God is the one who makes us righteous as we have faith in Jesus. So those four themes we should be able to see in the book of Acts. Now, for time and for just our sanity's sake, and because I want to get to communion and I want to enjoy that, I'm not going to pull out all of those themes each time we go to Acts, but I'll try and touch on them and want you to be able to see. What I love to do is I love to go to the book of Acts and I love to see people get saved. Because although many denominations surrounding us here, not only in the world, but certainly in our city, say that, you know, the book of Acts is closed and that's over with and God doesn't do miracles anymore and His Holy Spirit doesn't work in that way, and some denominations say you don't need to be born again, you know, and they take the book of Acts and they push it away like this. We believe that the book of Acts is ongoing to today because there's not an end to it. It doesn't. There's not a, oh, this is it. It's over with at the end of the book of Acts. No, it's going on today. So we should be able to identify at some level with what's happening there. So here's what I'm going to do. As I often say, I mean no disrespect by reading so fast, but I want to read through so we get the picture. I'll slow down at the part we need. You ready? Acts 2, 36. This is Peter on the day of Pentecost speaking to the Jews that are gathered there watching the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Acts 2:36, therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord, He's Master, and Christ, Messiah. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart, and they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? What is our response to this? And Peter said to them, repent. And turn from your sin. Repent. And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission, for the removal of sins. Not that baptize cleanses you from your sins, but you've received Jesus, and baptism is the sign that that has happened in your life. And he says, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the promise is to you and to your children, and to all who are afar off. That's not geographically, although it could be that. It's speaking not only Jews, but those who are far off are the Gentiles. As many as the Lord our God will call. You see some parallels there between what Paul has given to us in Romans, don't we? Look at Acts chapter 3, verse 14. Acts 3:14. Peter and John have gone up to the temple. There's a lame man there, and they have healed him. And Peter is being examined for this action that he has done. And he's speaking to the religious leaders, and he says, but you deny the Holy One and the Just, Acts 3:14, and ask for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the Prince of Life, speaking of Jesus, whom God raised from the dead, of which we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, Jesus, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yes, the faith which comes through him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I know that you did it in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But those things which God foretold by the mouth of all his prophets, that's the Old Testament, that the Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Verse 19, Romans 3, repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, washed away, forgiven, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. Christian, has there ever been a day that you've forgotten that your salvation was meant to be refreshing? Yeah, sometimes I forget that. Forgiveness of sin, salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ, it's to be refreshing. Look at Acts 5. We'll pick up a quick one in Acts 5, verse 30. Acts 5, verse 30, Peter and the apostles are called before the Jewish religious leadership. Acts 5, verse 30, the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. Jesus, God is exalted to his right hand to be prince and savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Repentance, turn away from the sin, and forgiveness of the sins, to be washed clean, to set free, to be forgiven. Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, this is a unique one that we will enjoy here. Acts 8, verse 29, Philip is called by the Holy Spirit to go and connect up with the Ethiopian eunuch. Acts 8:29, then the Holy Spirit said to Philip, go near and overtake this chariot. And so Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said to him, do you understand what you are reading? And he said, how can I unless someone guides me? And he asked Philip to come up into his chariot and sit with him. Verse 32, and the place in the scripture which he read was this, he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And who will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And so the eunuch is reading about the sacrifice, the blood being shed of this perfect Lamb of God. Verse 34, and the eunuch answered Philip and said, I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this, of himself or some other man? And Philip opened his mouth, and beginning at the scripture, he preached Jesus to him. What was the eunuch's response to the preaching of Jesus from the scriptures? Well, as they went down the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized? And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, if you entrust, if you desire to express your reliance upon the Lord Jesus Christ, you may be baptized. And the eunuch answered and said, I believe that Jesus, the Messiah, or the Christ, is the Son of God. And so there he was baptized. A Gentile, a fearer of God, a eunuch from Ethiopia. Look at Acts 10, verse 34. Acts 10, 34, Peter is called to the home of a Gentile, Cornelius. Acts 10, 34. Peter opened his mouth in Acts 10, 34, and he said, in truth I perceive that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. The word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That word you know, which was proclaimed throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all the things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree. Him God raised up on the third day and showed him openly, not to all the people, but to witnesses chosen before by God, even to us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that it is he who was ordained by God to be the judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets witness that through his name, whoever believes in him, believes in Jesus, will receive remission of sins. And you know the rest of the story. Cornelius and his house end up giving their life to Christ, receiving that gospel message, and become saved. Look at Acts 13. This is a very exciting one. Acts 13. Only have two more. Acts 13. Paul is preaching in the synagogue of Antioch. So he's preaching to Jews. He's declaring the gospel to religious people, to the Jews there in Antioch. Verse 26, "Men and brethren, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God." So that's interesting. That tells us that there were Gentiles in the room, not Jews. Gentiles in the room who loved God, who feared him, who wanted a relationship with him, but they were not Jewish. So we have a room here filled with Jews and Gentiles who fear God. And Paul says, "To you the word of this salvation has been sent. For those who dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not know Jesus, nor even the voices of the prophets which are read every Sabbath, have fulfilled them," fulfilled those prophets, "in condemning Jesus. And they found no cause for death in him. They asked Pilate that he should be put to death." It was the Romans that killed Jesus, verse 29. "Now when they had fulfilled all that was written concerning him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised Jesus from the dead. And he was seen for many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. And we declare to you glad tidings, that promise which was made to the fathers, God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus. As it is also written in the second psalm, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you,' and that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption. He has spoken thus, 'I will give you the sure mercies of David.' Therefore, he also says in another psalm, 'You will not allow your Holy One to see corruption.' For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell asleep, was buried with his fathers, and saw corruption. But he," Jesus, "whom God raised up, saw no corruption, because he was resurrected." Verse 38. "Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sins, and by him everyone who believes is justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses." So the law is not going to save you. Look at verse 48. "Now when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord, and as many as had been appointed to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was being spread throughout all the region." The last one I won't have you turn to because of time, but in Acts 16, Paul ministers the gospel to the Philippian jailer. The jailer says, "Lord," or says, "Paul," he says, "what must I do to be saved?" And Paul says to him, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household." And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And he rejoiced, having believed in God with all his household. So we can see through just those snippets of Acts, we can see this gospel message there. And the church, and of course, Romans was written after Acts, but the gospel, of course, you know, already there. We can see that gospel message there at work. So this morning, as we begin to prepare our hearts for communion, I want to think about this issue of sin, and I want to think about it in two ways. I want to think about the issue of sin as it relates to salvation for the one who is not saved, so turning from sin, receiving Jesus as their Savior. And I want to think about sin as it relates to thanksgiving for those of us that are saved, thankful for what we have been cleansed from. And I have two stories to tell you in preparation for Thanksgiving, or for communion. So, the first story I want to talk to you about is I had the opportunity recently to do some yard work. And I was doing some yard work on some trees that I had noticed some time ago. When I first noticed the trees, there was a vine coming up around the base of the trees. And I thought the vine looked very beautiful. So you have a tree growing up, and around this tree is some vine. It provides some nice greenery around the base of the tree. And I was inclined to cut down the vines, yet they looked so very beautiful, added some green to the tree, so I left them. I don't know how long ago that was, but I visited those vines recently, and they had grown up the trunk of the tree into its branches. And I noticed that this beautiful tree was now being impacted by these vines because they were weaving their way around the trunk and into the branches and into the foliage of the tree, where eventually, it seemed to me, they would kill it. So I reached up to the tip of the vines where they were there high in the tree, and I thought I would take the end of the vine and I would pull it and I would rip it down the trunk, freeing the trunk from the vine. But you know the craziest thing happened? When I pulled the tip of the vine easily pulled off the tree, very easily pulled off the tree. But at the first intersection where there was a leaf, which was probably only 3 inches, the vine broke. So what was left, I pulled that again, and another 3 inches, and another 3 inches, and another 3 inches. And this became ridiculous, because I would be there for the next year pulling these vines off the tree 3 inches at a time. So I looked down at the base, and where at the tip of the vine was very tiny. At the base where the vine came around the tree, it was quite thick, about the size of one of my fingers. It was separated out a little bit away from the base of the tree, and so I wrapped my hand around that vine, and I pulled. And as I pulled, that vine in its thickness, in its strength, now no longer green, but because it had been there so long, it was hardened, it had a tough skin on it, I was able to rip that vine all the way up the tree, and it came off. I pulled it up from its roots, and it ripped up the side of the tree, and it came off. And here's what I noticed, is that that vine had tentacles that had grown into the bark of that tree. And although I freed the tree from the vine by ripping it out from its base, I looked at the vine and I looked at the tree, and the tree, although set free from the vine, had been damaged by the vine. And I thought, what an amazing picture of sin in the life of the believer. The sin comes into the life of the believer, a beautiful tree, a redeemed tree, a glorious tree. And the sin comes into our life after salvation, and it looks rather beautiful there around the base of the tree. It adds some color. We might say it's fun. But left unattended, the vine comes and it grows up around the tree, and it starts to, over time, what was fun and what was beautiful and what was green begins to choke our beautiful tree. And if we're not serious about dealing with the sin, what we'll do is we'll pull at the tips. Oh, I'm dealing with my sin, and we'll break off 3 inches here. So I really want that out of my life. I'm gonna have to deal with that. I'll just break off a little bit. I want to deal with it, and we pull, and there's just a little bit comes off at a time. And yet we're struck and we're reminded by Jesus where he says, if your eye causes you to sin, gouge it out. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It would be better for you to enter into eternity without an eye, without a hand, than to miss out on eternity and keeping those things. And I think about that vine, and I think Jesus' way of dealing with salvation is reach to the base of that vine and to rip it off. The damage to the tree, it's already happened. The cleansing from the sin, oh, it's going to hurt. It's going to be painful. Think about it, maybe like ripping off a Band-Aid. And yet the healing and the refreshing and the strength and the life and the vitality that will come to that tree and that will come to that Christian. So we come to communion this morning thankful for the cleansing from our sin, mindful of this idea to not let the vines grow up around our beautiful tree. But I also want us to have the thought of the gospel in our heart as it relates to evangelism. And I want to read this story, this one from Spurgeon, that we would be ever sensitive to those around us that need the Lord Jesus. He writes, "Walk the streets by moonlight if you dare, and you will see sinners then. Watch when the night is dark and the wind is howling and the picklock is grating in the door, and you will see sinners then. Go to yon jail and walk through the wards and mark the men with heavy overhanging brows, men whom you would not like to meet at night, and there are sinners there. Go to the reformatories and note those who have betrayed a rampant juvenile depravity, and you will see sinners there. Go across the seas to the place where a man will gnaw a bone upon which is reeking human flesh, and there is a sinner there. Go where you will, you need not ransack earth to find sinners, for they are common enough. You may find them in every lane and street of every city, and town and village and hamlet. It is for such that Jesus died. If you will select me the grossest specimen of humanity, if he be but born of a woman, I will have hope of him yet, because Jesus Christ is come to seek and to save sinners. Electing love has selected some of the worst to be made the best. Pebbles of the brook, grace turns into jewels for the crown royal. Worthless dross, he transforms into pure gold. Redeeming love has set apart many of the worst of mankind to be the reward of the Savior's passion. Effectual grace calls forth many of the vilest of the vile to sit at the table of mercy, and therefore let none despair. Reader, by that love looking out of Jesus' tearful eyes, by that love streaming from those bleeding wounds, by that faithful love, that strong love, that pure, disinterested, and abiding love, by the heart and by the bowels of the Savior's compassion, we conjure you, turn not away as though it were nothing to you, but believe on him, and ye shall be saved. Trust your soul with him, and he will bring you to his Father's right hand in glory everlasting. Father, as we come before your table this morning, as we prepare to take the bread and the cup, Father, if there are those that come in need of salvation, Father, may they receive you, Lord Jesus, as their Lord and Savior, and entrust themselves to you today, that they would see you as being the one paying the price for their sin. They would see your blood being shed for their sin, cleansing them from their sin. That they would ask you to be the Lord of their life, the Savior of their soul. Father, if there would be those this morning coming to this time of thanksgiving, this time of communion, Lord, and the vine has grown up around the trees, they've been picking at it little by little, but have yet to have dealt with it seriously, to have uprooted it, to have ripped it off the trunk of their beautiful tree. Father, may this morning, in this moment, may that happen. Lord, that they would deal as severely with the sin in their life as Satan is dealing with the sin in their life. Father, the promise is that they will be set free. Lord, you will heal the wounds and the injuries. You will restore what the consuming locusts have eaten. You will make whole what has been damaged. Father, you will set free. As Lord, we would submit and surrender and ask you by your Holy Spirit to do that work. And we in reliance would trust you for that work. And Father, as we prepare our hearts for this communion, may we do so with hearts of thanksgiving for what is ours in the gospel of your Son, Christ Jesus, that we've been set free into life everlasting, that we've been justified, sanctified, and we will look forward to being an eternity being glorified with your Son, Christ Jesus. Father, in our thanksgiving, may that spur us on to an evangelism of sharing your Son, Christ Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Father, bless our time as we wait upon you and as we're served the bread and the